games, Brains and the Headbanging Life here. Track by track time, we're going to a fucking classic. Mm. An absolute barn burner of a classic. One of the most successful albums in the world by one of the most successful bands. You've seen the title is, of course, Appetite for Destruction by Guns N' Roses. Mm. The debut studio album by the hard rock band, released July 21st, 1987 by Geffen Records. Do you remember Geffen?
I remember them doing films like Beetlejuice.
Really?
It's a weird logo.
Okay, I didn't know they were in film as well. Mm. I just remember Geffen Records appearing quite a bit back in the day. I was 4 years old when this album came out.
Mm.
And amazingly, it was released to little mainstream attention in 1987. It was not until the following year that it became a massive success after the band had toured and received airplay with the singles Welcome to the Jungle, Paradise City, and, of course, Sweet Child O' Mine. It topped the Billboard 200 and became the best-selling debut album of all time, as well as the 11th best-selling album of all time in the United States. With over 30 million copies sold worldwide, it is also one of the best-selling records in the entire world. Mm. This is a very fucking successful album.
Yeah.
And I don't care where you are. You'll have heard, wherever you've lived, however long you've lived, you will have heard at least one track from this album in your life.
Yeah, because it's one of them bands that the hits are songs that people might put on at a party.
Yep.
To cater for people that go, oh, put some rock on. They put like Status Quo, they put some Guns N' Roses on to keep you happy.
Yep.
You end up karaoke songs and just,
It really, really is. Its mainstream appeal is deserved. It has incredible crossover with the singles, just the singles alone, really, let alone some of the lesser known tracks on the album.
Mm.
You can completely understand why this blew this band up.
Mm.
I will say it's not my favourite.
Mm.
Album of theirs. To be fair, I don't actually have a favorite Guns N' Roses album. I have tracks off every album that I put together as a best of. I would have a wicked 12-track Guns N' Roses best of album. That kind of thing, you know.
I feel like this album is like I say, it's prime. So it's prime Guns N' Roses. When you hear it, you think of like when they're first touring, and it's like raw and fresh. And I feel like now it's just like a bit of a sort of like bloated stadium behemoth to see them now.
Mm.
So I mean, I don't know if I'd be bothered seeing them now.
You know my stance on it. I am not paying £100 plus to sit in a stadium to watch a bunch of has-beens play songs from 30 years ago. You know, that money should go to bands of the future.
Yeah.
That's my stance on that. I'm not even going to apologise for being so harsh about it. But of course, this album has many, many bangers. And I am a fan.
Yeah.
I am a fan of Guns N' Roses. I'm just not a big fan. I never was back in the day either.
No, I didn't listen to Guns N' Roses for quite a while after I moved out of my family home. My brother was learning to play guitar.
Oh.
So he would start with the Guns N' Roses classics. And obviously after hearing Sweet Child, he would open your voices. Oh, shit. Starting again and again and again. It kind of, drove me mad. So I kind of avoided listening to Guns N' Roses.
And of course, that does lead on to the big problem, which is when you've heard tracks so many fucking times, can you appreciate them? You know, and that is a problem with several on this.
Yeah.
But let's get started. We begin with Welcome to the Jungle, which is the first major problem. That whole separation thing from having heard this track probably thousands of times. I was trying to listen to it with fresh ears. And here's the thing. It is a banger.
Mm.
That is everything great about Guns N' Roses in it. It's groovy, it's sexy, it's energetic, and it's very fucking catchy. The guitar riffs are so bloody good, and it really gets you moving. I think Axl sounds great here. Mm. Aside from the weird sex noises he makes during the first solo, though, it is a brilliant opener and such a crowd pleaser.
Mm.
Like, it's so such a crowd pleaser.
Oh,
yeah, but it is a great song.
So I've got the same thing, I sort of called it a good time banger.
Yeah.
Like you say, it's one of them songs where if you went to like an early Guns N' Roses gig and they kind of started with this,
If I was there, I'm telling you, even if I was being the most miserable, this style, I wouldn't be able to help myself. Welcome to the jungle.
I love all that.
But my only negative, like I said, is those weirds, and I just don't like them.
Well, I feel like the debut album, they're throwing it all. Axel's throwing it all in there.
Vince.
I don't know why I went for Vince. I don't know why. Yeah. Axel's throwing it all in there. But yeah, I definitely, at the most played ones, I feel like I enjoy this one more, if that makes sense.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I don't know if I, of all the most played ones, if this is the one I enjoy the most.
Okay.
It's so easy. Mm. I love that little guitar strumming at the start. Then when it kicks in, it's got a different vibe to the former track. So for me, showing off some early versatility in the band, especially with the vocals. Mm. Catchy, sexy, it's great. When it slows down, I think it's particularly strong, especially as it builds back up with some bite. Yeah, I think it's a great song.
I say it's a different type of vocal style. I like the same way they use Fuck Off.
Yeah.
I think it's like it's just made to play live. You know, like, yeah, I really, really do dig that. Slightly dark undertone to it.
Mm.
Sort of talk about being like bored and stuff, you know, everything's easy and things like that, you know, just don't care. And Slash really shines on this one.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, he shines bright. The guitar work is untouchable, no question on that. Night Train. Needs more cowbell, if you know SNL reference. I really like this. A bit of snark to the vocals while having a good time filled to the rhythm. The build and intensity keeps it interesting, and the soloing is on point, obviously.
Mm. Axl hits the high notes, and it's a really great rock and roll tune.
Yeah.
I've not listened to this album for so long, and it reminds me of how strong they were.
Yeah.
This album, like, the usual oomph of Guns N' Roses.
Yeah, but the first half of it in particular is really, really fucking strong. Mm. Out to Get Me. The vocals here are super sharp. This is Axl at his highest, and I don't love it. It's saved by the layering and the kick-ass riffs, though. It was never one of my favourite back in the day, but I actually enjoyed it more now, being one that I haven't listened to loads and loads, because it's got chaotic groove.
Yeah, I that's sort of similar to what I was kind of getting to. Such a strong track, screeching guitars. It's saying I'm fucking innocent. So like when he throws in the swear words, it's kind of that snarl on the song. I really enjoy it.
Yeah, just right, like a bit of punk to the rock and roll side of thing as well.
I really appreciate that, because they kind of, it kind of also shows they weren't worried about being played on the radio and things like that. You know, like you kind of, I know you can cut songs out, you can edit words out, but I feel like that was kind of a bit more rock and roll than not having the F's and Jeff's in it.
Okay, I don't know if I agree with you in that, because there are certain songs in it that are purposely designed for radio.
Yeah.
Mr. Brownstone, how good is that choppy start? Yeah. If that doesn't get your motor running, I think there's probably something wrong with you. Even if you hate this band, that thing, like that doesn't go, but you go, okay. I really like this track. Mm. It's so groovy that it makes the body involuntarily move, especially when it gets faster and more garbled.
Mm.
It's starting to sound a bit tired, but man, the riffs are on fire as it goes on. Yeah.
Okay, it feels like such an 80s Sunset Strip party and having a good time.
Cool, yeah.
Nice, like, slidey guitars. I don't know the technical term for it. I really enjoyed that. And like I said, it just gets you, like, you want to, like, groove. It's like, you used to do a little, but a little was not enough.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, everyone said that kind of night where it's like, I've gone and have another drink. Obviously, in their terms, it might not have been just a drink.
Yeah,
just a
shandies. Of course.
Maybe something else, but, you know.
Allegedly.
Just a shandies. Yeah, allegedly, all right.
Paradise City. Mm. I have a major soft spot for this track because, obviously, it's related to my son. Going back to Paradise City, Burnout Paradise, which was like one of the earliest games he ever played, and obviously that kicked him with Paradise City. It's one of the earliest rock songs I think he ever heard.
Mm.
So I've got a lot of soft spot for it. But I was, well, I always remember the video. I think the video was banging for Paradise City, the live stadium and stuff like that.
It was pretty cool.
The fact that I love it feels as a track like a stadium song. It is incredibly catchy.
Yeah.
I mean, that intro, that especially with that drum beat. Dum,
dum,
dum, dum, like, you cannot be like, that's fucking cool.
It feels like it's on the top sort of 100 lists of like, intros. I remember
when you
songs like that would be up there. And even like the whistle just tells you, yeah, we're going now. That's what I like really enjoyed about it. I call it another good time banger. It's overplayed
in the scheme of things.
But I just love the whole idea behind like the grandness of it. I really enjoyed that. And for a debut album as well, to kind of come out big bangers like this, you're like, yeah, this is what we are.
Yeah, you were hot. You were hot shit.
Yeah.
I also think I wanted to add as well, I think it's got one of the best vocal performances on the album. I think this is one of Axl's best. Take me down to the paradise city where the grass is green and the girls are pretty. Oh, won't you please take me home? My Michelle. I like this too. Catchy rhythm that shifts tempo into the chorus. Axel's pretty high pitched, but he's not front and centre here, so it makes it more bearable for me.
I feel like it was a little bit more, slightly more sleazy. It felt a bit more sleazy at the beginning when it kicks in and stuff.
Okay.
I really enjoyed the guitar work in this one.
Yeah.
But yeah, it will be like my top my top choices, but I enjoyed it.
Yeah, yeah, it's fine. It's like it's a good song. That's it. I Think About You, a frantic burst of radio rock. I thought it was funny that this wasn't a major track for them because this is radio rock fucking 101. Like, I was really surprised this wasn't another single. Maybe they had planned it and it just didn't happen and he only did three in the end. It ticks all the right boxes for them. And it even has more cowbell. Maybe it's something to do with the fact, I think, well, actually, I wrote this at the end. I was like, maybe it's the fact that it's just nothing spectacular.
Yeah.
Like, that's its problem. It's perfectly fine, energetic and groovy, but that's about it.
I really enjoy it, but I feel like if I said to my mum, oh, here's a Guns N' Roses song, she'd go, oh, I like that one.
Yeah.
So there was tracks like that where you can go, oh, I like that one.
Yeah.
I enjoy it. I think it's a nice song. It's like, it doesn't go too far either way. But yeah, it would be my top one.
Sweet Child of Mine. Mm. I was dreading this when it came on. A track that I'm telling you, I will immediately switch off the moment it begins. And truthfully, I couldn't separate myself from it. This was one I couldn't do. One of the most overplayed tracks ever.
Okay.
I'm telling you now, do not play this at your wedding. Don't be those people that play this at your wedding. Don't do it. I get it. It's very simple though. Mm-hmm. Very catchy. And that obviously has a ton of mass appeal. Mm-hmm. I just can't stand it. I was never a fan back in the day because it's so repetitive.
Mm-hmm.
But age has made me hate it.
Yeah.
I've got nothing good to say about it. I hate it. And I listened to it about halfway through for this track by track.
Mm.
And I went, that's it, I'm done. There's no point. This isn't, there's nothing, I'm not gaining anything new from this. Oh, I could say, well, the main riff's good and so on. But it's just that. That's all it is.
Yeah. Yeah. I overplayed, good song, played to death.
Good song.
I enjoyed it when I hadn't heard it like a million times when I was younger. Yeah, I enjoyed it. But again, time and overplayed and, yeah, just, it's knackered it and I can't appreciate it at all now.
Yeah. You're crazy. This saves me. Woof, the frenzied blur of instruments and the frantic singing makes its mark. I was feeling this purely because it was refreshing after the horror show of the previous track. However, it's just not that memorable.
Yeah, I say, it's a nice change of pace from the previous Sweet Child of Mine. And obviously, Think About You and Sweet Child of Mine is a bit more kind of ballady.
It is a fucking ballad.
Rock ballad. So come back with this, it's like, oh no, okay, we're still like dirty rock and roll.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Penultimate track, Anything Goes. Mm. Is that a fucking kazoo? Is that a fucking kazoo? Because that's what my ears heard. I thought that was dumb. I like the way Axel's whine sounds like a harmonica.
Mm.
Like his whine, I was like, oh, is that harmonica? No, that's Axel.
Yeah.
Like, that was weird.
Great range of his voice, yeah.
It finally gets good once they drop that fucking kazoo-like noise.
Mm.
But I'm on edge waiting for it to kind of come back because I really didn't like it. So much so that it stops being enjoyable, which is the same shame as it's got some classy riffs.
Yeah, so I enjoyed the riffs of it. Very GNR. You can imagine that Anything Goes was said nightly. I mean, talk about it. Anything My Way, Anything Goes tonight. It's like, they were partying.
Okay. Finale, Rocket Queen. It's a bang over closer. This is the Guns N' Roses I've always enjoyed. A bit of mood, a bit of old school rock to the sound, and a ton of young peppy imagination. I don't even mind the distortion on the vocals because it really works with the kick-ass groove of the guitars.
Mm.
It's a very strong closer and one that I find myself humming afterwards.
Yeah, I said the same thing. It's like a good track to finish on. Builds up nicely. I thought it was a little long, but a good track to finish on.
Okay.
So I like the nice echoey effect on the vocals.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, top three tracks then.
I put Welcome to the Jungle,
mm-hmm.
Mr. Brownstone, and Think About You.
Oh, well, pretty much exactly the same. The difference being that I have Rocket Queen instead of Think About You.
Yeah.
I've got to Welcome to the Jungle, which I initially had as Paradise City, but I thought Welcome to the Jungle was more energetic.
I think the Shannon on the Knees kind of put it back in the top three for me.
Okay, yeah. I think Paradise City more because of the connection initially, and then I was like, no, which song's better? And it is Welcome to the Jungle. Mr. Brownstone's a great track as well. And Rocket Queen just proper turned me on at the end.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. That's Guns N' Roses' Appetite for Destruction. Let us know your thoughts in the comments. Thank you very much for watching. You can check us out on gbhbell.com as well as on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and Tumblr. Go to Patreon to help us out over there. That's patreon.com/GBHBL, as well as Big Cartel, where you can find some of our merchandise. We have a podcast running on SoundCloud and Apple Podcasts. And of course, if you like this video, do us a favour, hit the subscribe button and help the channel grow. Games, horror and heavy metal, what else is life for?